Good morning, all. We're here today for a hearing in the matter of CFI 1, 2017, before His Excellency Justice Omar Muhairi. The claimants represented by Global Advocacy and Legal Counsel. Lead counsel is Sharon Mahan. The defendants represented by Emirates Legal. Lead counsel is Sayed Mujtaba.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, Rana. Your Honor, I act for DIFC Investments LLC, the claimant in these proceedings. Your Honor, if I might just check that you have all of the hearing bundles in front of you, you should have four volumes.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Your Honor, the claim is a straightforward one. The claimant is seeking a declaration as to the termination of 72 contracts entered into it between it and the defendant. The claimant was and is the owner of 72 units in a project known as New Bridge Hill 2, which is based in Motor City. On or around the 3rd of May 2015, the defendant agreed to purchase those 72 units from the claimant for a cumulative purchase price of 105,134,400
dirhams. You say it again, the amount, how much?
105,134,400.
Okay, and the 10 million is part of that whole unit, or whole price?
That's the cumulative purchase price for the 72 units.
Which I'm referring to the check.
No, the check involved in the proceedings, Your Honor, was a security deposit, which was 10% of the cumulative purchase price.
But it's part of the whole amount?
10% of the whole amount, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, correct. Your Honor, if I could ask you to take up, please, bundle 3 and turn to tab 18. And page 344.
The contracts.
The contracts. Your Honor will see there a complete copy set of the contracts in question.
Which is 72 contracts.
There are 72 contracts there,
and
Your Honor.
All of them are identical. Same contracts.
Yes, exactly. So, Your Honor, we'll see that this is a standard form contract for the sale and purchase of property on the Land Department's standard form. And if you will see at the top, Your Honor, each contract has an individual contract number which is issued when the electronic version of the contract is generated. Aside from the particulars on the first few pages of the contracts, they are in essentially identical terms. Your Honor, the material provisions of the contracts for our purposes appear on pages 347 and 348 of the bundle. In particular, Your Honor, if I can read to you clause 2, the seller undertakes to complete all procedures and requirements to transfer the property to the buyer's name at Dubai Land Department immediately after taking possession of the agreed price under this contract, and not later than Sunday, 7th of June, 2015.
Okay, this is the time frame. Is to the buyer to complete or to the seller to complete his transaction?
Your Honor, the understanding between the parties was that the transaction would complete by the 7th of June. Now, for various reasons, that wasn't able to be done, and the parties did agree an extension of time until the 18th of June for that transaction to complete.
Which is, can I consider this date as the deadline to complete all the process?
Initially, that was the intended date to complete the whole process, yes, Your Honor. Your Honor, then clause 3 provides that the buyer agrees to pay to the seller, firstly at 3A, a security deposit of 10%, and that is the check that Your Honor has referred to already, check number 113301.
Yeah, this is my question. Is the check is part of the total amount of the sale price?
Yes.
It seems to me that the amount is, there's two amounts, the three actually.
Yes, Your Honor.
The 10%?
Yes.
And the check, which is the 10% of the sale?
That's correct.
And it's mentioned here is part from the whole amount, correct?
Correct, Your Honor. So the contract is specifying that the 10% security check is in relation to the cumulative purchase price for the 72 units. And then I think the other amount that Your Honor is referring to is
The total amount.
Is the individual amount for the unit, which appears at 3B.
Okay.
So, Your Honor, Clause 3 provides that the buyer is to pay to the seller the security deposit as well as the sale price of the individual units. And that is either by manager's check or any other guaranteed method of payment that is acceptable. And in particular, that is specified here as being a one-year irrevocable validity SBLC, which is a standby letter of credit, issued by eStrategy or Investimentos Bank to be advised by Mashreq Bank on the name of DIFC Investments LLC. And that SBLC was to be for the cumulative total purchase price of the 72 units. And that was to be issued to the DIFC on the date of receiving no objections from the developer for the purchase of the properties by the defendant. And it was intended that that SBLC should be able to be encashed immediately upon being presented. And importantly, the transfer shall happen once the money is realized by the sellers. So, Your Honor, clauses two and three make it very clear that the transfer of the title of the properties will only take place upon receipt of the full amount of the purchase price by the claimant into its account, and that obviously makes commercial sense as well. The next relevant provision that I would like to draw Your Honor's attention to is Clause 6, which is the termination provision. And that clause, Your Honor, provides, in the event that the buyer fails to pay the payments as agreed date in Clause 3, or fails to complete the transfer on the agreed date due to his own act or omissions, then the seller has the right to terminate this contract, and he shall be entitled to retain the deposit as long as the termination of the contract was due to violation of the agreed terms, unless they agreed amicably to different terms or dates. And Your Honor, I'll also just point out that at Clause 17, the governing law is stated to be that the contract shall be construed in accordance with the local and federal laws applicable within the Emirate of Dubai.
And which law you refer to?
Specifically to local laws, non-DIFC laws, Your Honor.
Why?
I beg your pardon, why?
Why?
Your Honor, because this is in relation to a property transaction, and therefore the applicable laws would be the local laws of the jurisdiction where the property is located.
Are you aware of the Article 3 of the Law Number 8/2004, the federal law?
I've probably seen it, Your Honor. I don't remember it off the top of my head.
Which is referred to the exemption to apply the federal commercial and civil law to DIFC, which the civil code exempt to apply within the DIFC. However, DIFC is part of the DIFC authority, correct? Or
it's a DIFC establishment, Your Honor.
So we have a contract law here.
We have a
contract, DIFC contract law, which is supersede.
I don't know, Your Honor, that I would agree that the DIFC contract law necessarily applies. I think that a DIFC establishment can still elect to...
But still, we don't have a power to apply the federal law because it's exempt from applying by the federal law number 8, 2004. Anyway, I will ask you to do submission on this.
I will make a submission later on that, Your Honor, if I may. I will look into that point. My understanding that is, in relation to property transactions, it is the law of the jurisdiction where the property is located that necessarily governs the transaction. And, Your Honor, the registration of these properties would inevitably be with the Dubai Lands Department, and therefore the relevant procedures would necessarily fall under non-DIFC law.
Okay.
But we can discuss that further a little later once I've had a chance to look.
But still, I need a submission from you on this point.
Thank you, Your Honor. I will look into that later. Thank you. Your Honor, the claimant's case is a simple one. It never received the payment of the purchase price, and therefore the defendant has not performed his obligations under the contracts. And for that reason, the claimant wishes to terminate the contracts. The defendant says that he issued standby letters of credit for the amount of the purchase price and subsequently for the amount of the security deposit. That is not in dispute between the parties, Your Honour. However, those standby letters of credit were not able to be encashed by the claimant's bank, Mashreq Bank, due to compliance reasons. And if Your Honour could turn to Bundle 2, please, and page 328.
Page?
328.
Yeah.
Your Honour will see there an email from Mashreq Bank to Mr. Mustafa Ahad from DIFC Investments confirming, please note that the SBLCs have been received at our counters and they are referred back to the issuing bank due to compliance issues. We have not advised these SBLCs to DIFC. Your Honour, as it turned out, those were not trivial compliance issues. When Mashreq Bank refused to advise the standby letters of credit, the defendant sought to have a relationship established between his bank, E-Strategy or Investor Mentors Bank, and the claimant's bank, Emirates MBD. Again, that is not disputed. And if Your Honour looks at Bundle 1, tab 14, at page 106,
the witness statement of Mr. Saleh.
This is the first witness statement of Mr. Saleh Al-Akrabi.
Okay.
And Your Honour, Mr. Al-Akrabi refers to this potential relationship between a strategy or Investor Mentors Bank and Emirates NBD. And confirms that Emirates NBD did not in fact have a relationship at the time with the defendant's bank. But there was an attempt to establish a relationship. However, for whatever reason, Emirates NBD revoked the procedures to establish that relationship. And so it would not have been possible for the SBLCs to be advised by Emirates NBD. And if Your Honour would like to see the revocation of the process, that can be found at Bundle 2, page 305.
Okay. So, there now?
Yes, if you'd like to look at that, Your Honour.
Yeah, this is a civil case from Dubai Court, right?
No, you're at page 305, Your Honour, in Bundle 2.
Yeah, I saw that.
Okay. This was the process that was commenced to establish the relationship between the two banks. And it's perhaps not very clear to read, but if you see, the authorization to send status has been revoked. And we understand that that was essentially Emirates NBD revoking the process.
But at the beginning, they start with the Mashreq Bank, right?
Yes, correct, Your Honour. And Mashreq Bank confirmed, as we saw, that they were not able to advise on the SBLC because of compliance issues.
Okay. Do you have an witness statement of Mr. Ayman Fawzi?
No, Your Honour.
From Mashreq Bank? Because it's, is it somewhere here they have?
Yes, Your Honour. It's referred to in the first witness statement of Mr. Al-Akrabi. Mm-hmm. So that is on page 105 of Bundle 1, Your Honour.
Yeah, it's front of me.
Yes, and that's paragraph 16. He refers to the judgments. And paragraph 17, where he says it can be seen from the judgments that a representative of Mashreq Bank submitted a statement in the criminal proceedings to the effect that the defendant's company, Interglobe General Trading, was under investigation by Interpol, and that Interpol has issued a warrant in relation to the defendant himself.
Was it that this is an Mr. Ayman Fawzi's statement front of criminal court in Dubai?
Yes, and reflected in the judgment, Your Honor.
But you don't submit it here before me.
The judgment is...
No, not judgment. The witness statement of Mr. Ayman.
The witness statement. No, Your Honor. So accordingly, Your Honor, neither Mashreq Bank nor Emirates NBD were able to advise the transaction and to advise the SBLC. The defendant says that it took steps to secure the SBLCs, and he says that this demonstrates his intention to perform the contracts. And I can refer you to paragraph 6 of the defendant's skeleton argument, Your Honor, where that is set out. The defendant's intention is, of course, immaterial if he never actually performs his obligation under the contract. He may have had the best intentions in the world, but simply reissuing SBLCs that had no prospect of being in cash due to serious compliance concerns by financial institutions about the defendant and his company go nowhere towards fulfilling his obligations under the contract. Your Honor, as a result of the failure by the defendant to make payment of the purchase price to the claimant issued a letter terminating the contracts, and that can be found at Bundle 2, page 308. That letter is dated the 8th of July, 2015, Your Honor.
308.
And the claimant refers to the property sales contracts that were signed on the 3rd of May, the subsequent extension to the deadline for completion of the transaction. Please note that we have provided you with the NOC from the master developer authorizing the transfer of the 72 units. However, you have failed to submit a valid irrevocable standby letter of credit by the agreed date. Accordingly, we now exercise our right as per clause 6 of the contract to terminate the same and to encash your security deposit of 10%, which is currently held by Blue Chip Real Estate.
But after this letter, several meetings and correspondence between parties, can you consider it as an extension of the time?
Your Honor, I don't think that is the view that the claimant necessarily took. Certainly there were additional meetings, and if the defendant had been able to demonstrate an ability to make payment of the purchase price, mm-hmm. I'm sure that an arrangement could have been worked out. But ultimately, what Your Honour will see is that there were further letters issued by the claimant to the defendant reiterating its intention to terminate the contracts. And those are found in the same bundle, Your Honour, at page 318.
Which I need a clear copy from this letter.
Okay.
I cannot read it clearly.
Your Honor, I can read it out for you, but I'll certainly provide you with a clear...
I saw that it's before me, and I tried to highlight it, but it's difficult.
Okay, my apologies, Your Honor. Mine is a little clearer, but essentially, Your Honor, the document refers to the property sales contracts against a guaranteed method of payment in the name of DIFC to occur not later than the 18th of June 2015. A 10% security deposit was paid by you on the date of signing the property sales contract to protect DIFC's interests in the event that you default on your obligations thereunder. DIFC could have insisted on the security deposit being paid in cash. However, DIFC accepted a security deposit check instead. The agreed method of payment was a one-year irrevocable SBLC in the name of DIFC for the purchase price to be issued on the date when DIFC would receive no objection certificates from the developer Union Properties for the transfer of the 72 units comprising the property into your name. Then it goes on to talk about the way that the SBLC was issued. It was in fact issued in the name of the defendant's company, Emirates Moon General Trading LLC, instead of in DIFC's name. And then the next paragraph, Your Honour, therefore, without prejudice to DIFC's rights under the property sales contract, DIFC tried in good faith to accommodate your bank's requirements by providing you with a letter dated 14th of June 2015, which you submitted to your bank, which, as we understand, was not sufficient to release the funds in favour of DIFC. DIFC was also being asked to establish a link between DIFC and the ENBD bank account and its strategy arm, or to provide a substitute bank account. These were new requirements which were not entirely clear to DIFC, and it is certainly not what DIFC had originally contracted for under the property sales contract. By the 18th of June 2015, you were unable to abide by your obligations under the property sales contract, and at that point in time, it was perfectly legitimate to DIFC to encash the 10% security deposit as per Clause 6 of the property sales contract. The security deposit check was deposited in DIFC's bank account on 30th of July 2015 after RERA had given its approval for the same to be encashed. But the security deposit was not honoured due to unavailability of funds in your account. DIFC hereby wishes to terminate the property sales contract due to your failure to pay the purchase price by the deadline date of 18 June 2015, and DIFC wishes to recover the security deposit amount to which it is entitled. And it goes on over the page, Your Honour. DIFC therefore urges you to submit sufficient funds into your bank account to honour the security deposit check, failing which DIFC shall have no option but to file a police complaint to protect its interests. And then...
This is the last letter sent from DIFC to Mr. Ria.
No, Your Honour, there are two more. There is one at page 326 of the same bundle.
Which is, I need a clear copy as well, which is the 25th of August 2015.
Yes, that's correct, Your Honour.
Yeah, I need a clear copy, please.
Certainly. And, Your Honour, again, on page 327, I believe the following day, on the 26th of August 2015. And that simply states, please refer to our letter of 25 August 2015, which is self-explanatory and whereby DIFC reiterates its position that it is no longer bound by the property sales contract. Your Honour, the claimant says that it is entitled to terminate the contracts for a failure by the defendant to pay the purchase price pursuant to Clause 3 of the contract. The contractual basis for termination is set out in Clause 6 of the contract, and the wording is clear, and we've just read it out, Your Honour. In our submission, the word or, after the reference to Clause 3, makes the failure to complete the transfer separate and distinct from any failure to pay the payments. Therefore, there would be two potential sources of breach pursuant to this clause, the first being failure to make the payments, and the second being a failure to complete the transfer on the agreed due date. Accordingly, Your Honour, it is our submission that pursuant to the contract, we do not need to show that a failure of performance was the defendant's own fault due to an act or omission on his part. Rather, all we need to show is that he failed to make the payments that were due under the contracts. Pursuant to, I'm going to take Your Honour to the provisions of the Civil Code, which I believe are applicable, Your Honour, but keeping in mind that you've asked for submission subsequently as to the applicability of that law. So, Your Honour, if it is correct and the Civil Code applies, we would refer to Article 267 of the UAE Civil Code, which provides...
Dealing with the contract, termination of the contract.
Yes, correct. So where the contract is valid and binding on the parties, it can only be cancelled in three circumstances, and the first is by mutual consent, the second is by court order, and the third is under a provision of law. Now, I think there's no question of there being any provision of law which is applicable here that might serve to cancel the contracts. The other provision that I would draw Your Honour's attention to is Article 271 of the Civil Code, and the terms of a contract can state that a contract shall be regarded as cancelled automatically without a judicial order upon non-performance of the obligations arising out of it. That article, as I understand, is widely accepted to mean that the words without judicial order would need to be written into the termination provision for that to take effect. In absence of those specific words appearing in the contract, a party wishing to cancel a contract must do so with the mutual consent of the defaulting party or apply to the court for a court order. So, Your Honour, even though Clause 6 of the contract provides a basis for termination for failure to pay the purchase price, it does not specify that such termination is automatic without the need for a judicial order. And therefore, in the absence of that wording, and in the absence of an operation of a law to terminate the contract, we are left with two possible scenarios, the first of which is a mutual consent between the parties to cancel the contract, or a cancellation by the court. Your Honour, the defendant says that there is no mutual consent to cancel the contracts, and that can be found at Bundle 1, Tab 15. Which is the third witness statement of the defendant.
Of Mr. Zia.
Of Mr. Zia.
Okay, which part do you want to refer to me?
Paragraph 16, Your Honour. At various points throughout paragraph 16, at A, for example, the defendant makes it clear that there has been no mutual consent to terminate. So 16A, 16D, 16F. And then, Your Honour, over the page to paragraph 35, the very last sentence, the claimant could have waived its right to seek the security deposit and sought a mutual termination of the contracts. The implication is that there has been no mutual termination of the contracts, Your Honour. So that leaves us with Article 267 and cancellation by order of the court, which needs to be read in conjunction with Article 272, which provides that where a party does not do that which he ought to do under the contract, the other party may require, or request, as I understand is the better translation, may request the court to order that the contract be performed or cancelled. Your Honour, there is no doubt that the defendant has not fulfilled the obligation to pay the purchase price. If you turn to the first witness statement of Mr. Rajesh Parikh, which is at Bundle 1, Tab 11, and if Your Honour can turn to page 81, at paragraph 30, Mr. Parikh refers to the breaches by the defendant of clauses 3A and 3B of the contracts, which are the provisions for the payment of 3A is the security deposit check, and 3B is the payment of the purchase price. And over the page at paragraph 32, Mr. Parikh states, accordingly, the required payment by Mr. Zia of the total purchase price to DIFC remained outstanding. In addition, Your Honour, if you turn to the first witness statement of the defendant, which is at tab 12 of the same bundle, at page 88, starting at page 88, Your Honour, and paragraph 23, approximately halfway through the paragraph, the claimant does not deny the fact that all necessary steps were taken by me in this regard. Mashreq Bank informed me at the last moment that they could not transfer the money to the claimant's bank account due to some compliance issues. If Your Honour then turns to paragraph 30 of the same witness statement, the last sentence of that paragraph, I had in good faith reissued the SCLCs when they were rejected by the claimant's bankers. Paragraph 35 over the page, and the last part of that paragraph, the payment could not be successfully made as the claimant's bankers could not transfer it to the claimant's account once the claimant's bankers received the money. And paragraph 36, Your Honour, in the very first sentence, the defendant confirms that the necessary funds were not credited to the claimant's account. So So, Your Honour, it is the claimant's submission that by failing to make payment of the purchase price to the claimant, the defendant has not performed his obligations under the contract, which gives rise to a right to the claimant to seek to have the contracts terminated. Even if Your Honour doesn't accept our interpretation of Clause 6 of the contracts and finds that there is a requirement to demonstrate that the failure to perform an obligation is required to be as a result of the defendant's own act or omission, well, Your Honour, there are two points in relation to that. Firstly, is it really open to the defendant to say that it is not his fault that there were compliance issues that prevented Mashreq Bank advising the SBLC? Surely that can't be the case. These were actually very serious compliance issues. And if you turn to the first witness statement of Mr. Al-Akrabi, which we have already looked at, paragraph 17, the criminal judgment referred to therein, commenced by the Dubai Public Prosecutor, refers to the evidence heard by the court that the defendant's company was under investigation by Interpol and that Interpol had issued a warrant against the defendant. So the defendant cannot seriously maintain that those compliance issues were not of his own making. Again, Your Honour, even if you accept the defendant's interpretation of Clause 6, and you were to accept that his failure to perform his obligations were not as a result of his own act or omission, the claimant still has recourse to a statutory right to terminate the contract. And again, Your Honour, I'd refer you to Articles 276 and 272 of the UAE Civil Code. Your Honour, those are my submissions in relation to the interpretation of the contract and the performance of the contract. Your Honour, the defendant says that the claimant has wrongfully commenced its claim using the Part 8 procedure. That is incorrect. The Part 8 procedure can be utilised where there is unlikely to be any substantial dispute of fact, and the essence of this claim is simply whether the contracts have been or should now be terminated. The only substantial issue for determination by the court is whether or not the defendant has done that which he ought to do under the contract, that is, to pay the purchase price to the claimant. The claimant never received the amount of the purchase price into its accounts, and that is not disputed by the defendant, and we've already been to those provisions of the defendant's witness statement that demonstrate that. The defendant says that a substantial dispute exists because he says that the claimant did not do everything that it might have done in order to assist Emirates NBD to establish a relationship with the claimant's bank. That is not a sensible argument, Your Honour. What possible documents could the claimant have provided to Emirates NBD that would allow it to overlook its reasons for rejecting the relationship? Establishing that nature of a relationship is something between the financial institutions themselves, and in any event, the defendant hasn't identified the documents that DIFC may have presented to Emirates NBD that would have overcome any obstacles. Your Honour, Part 8 does not require that there be no dispute of fact. And guidance in relation to this can be sought from an English case of Forest Heath. And if Your Honour would like me to take you to that, that's in Bundle 4 at Tab 4. And paragraph 30, Your Honour. This court is also prepared to deal with certain limited factual issues which might arise on a Part 8 claim and does so by way of a hybrid procedure involving an element of fact finding. In those cases, a short hearing can dispose of any disputed fact based on a decision after hearing oral evidence. And he refers to the observations of Justice Coulson in Vitpool Building Service. Your Honour, I would also direct you to paragraph 47 in the same judgment. And around halfway through that paragraph, Your Honour, this is not a case where there is no substantial dispute of fact or where the disputed issue of fact could be determined by a short hearing with a narrow focus without disclosure. The scope of the factual issue is likely to widen on further investigation, and any outcome would leave unresolved uncertainty and argument between the parties. So So, Your Honour, English authority contemplates the potential for use of a hybrid form of the Part A procedure where necessary. But, Your Honour, my submission is that the so-called disputed facts in this case are far from reaching a threshold that would even require the court to consider a hybrid model of the Part A procedure. And certainly, there is not sufficient dispute to warrant the proceedings being conducted pursuant to Part 7. The court has before it all of the documents and all of the information necessary to make a decision as to a declaration of the termination of the contracts. There is no need for further disclosure, and no further documents have been identified by the defendant that might be available to the court in the event that the Part 7 proceedings were to be utilised. And in my submissions, there is nothing to be gained from oral testimony from the witnesses. And it hasn't been suggested that oral testimony is required. Essentially, Your Honour, the dispute in question is one of law, not one of fact, and that is an eminently suitable dispute for the Part 8 procedure, particularly as the only remedy that is being sought is a declaration. Your Honour, if I may, I would like to take you through the defendant's skeleton argument and specifically the section that deals with the disputed facts.
The declaration you want, the contract is terminated on which date?
Sorry, can you repeat that, Your Honour?
The declaration you want from the court, the termination date, and which date?
Yes, Your Honour, the claim is formulated on two bases. Either that the court declares that the contracts were terminated with effect from the 8th of July 2015, which is the date of the first letter purporting to terminate. Alternatively, if Your Honour doesn't agree that that was a valid termination or that it requires the order of the court, then with effect from a declaration of the court now.
And the 72 units still exist or it's sold?
The
72 units.
Yes, they still exist, Your Honour, and they're still owned by DIFC.
And still your client hold that units until finalise the issue of the termination contract?
Yes, they want a declaration from the court so that they know what their legal obligations are in relation to those contracts, Your Honour. So, Your Honour, if you could turn up, please, the defendant's skeleton argument, which is at tab 2 of bundle 4. Yeah. And specifically, it's paragraphs 45 to 55.
Page 12?
Yes, correct. And Your Honour, if you don't mind, I'll take you through paragraph by paragraph to try and identify what the actual substantial issues are that are said to be in dispute between the parties. Well, Your Honour, paragraph 45 does not set out a factual dispute. It is only an assertion of the defendant's objection to the Part 8 procedure. Over the page of paragraph 46, again, this paragraph does not set out a dispute, only the defendant's interpretation of the claimant's position. Paragraph 47 contains no substantial dispute of fact. It is agreed that the SBLCs were issued and that due to compliance reasons, those SBLCs were not able to be in cash to the claimant's account. That does not amount to the payment of the purchase price to the claimant, but there is no substantial dispute of fact there. Again, paragraph 48 does not set out a dispute as to the facts. Paragraph 49 disputes the interpretation of Article 6 of the contract. Your Honour, that is a question of law, not a question of fact. It is a question of construction of the contract, and therefore we say eminently suitable for the adoption of the Part 8 procedure. Paragraph 50 does not contain a dispute as to the facts. The defendant seems to suggest here that he should be entitled to have the contracts performed even if the claimant has not received the payment of the purchase price. That reasoning is not understood, but again, it is a question of law, not of fact. The defendant cannot seriously suggest that by issuing the SPLC that he has made good on the purchase price to the claimant, even though the claimant has never received that purchase price. And Your Honor, paragraph 51 is the question as to whether the proper interpretation of clause 6 requires that a breach by the defendant be due to his own act or omission. That is a question of construction of the contract. And Your Honor, you have the claimant's submissions on the proper interpretation of clause 6 of that contract. At paragraph 52 of the defendant's skeleton argument, it is said that all the facts and circumstances presented by the parties are totally at variance with one another. And Your Honor, as you can see, we're struggling to identify a single factual issue that is genuinely in dispute, let alone a substantial factual dispute. Your Honor, paragraph 53 of the skeleton refers to a number of letters. The existence of those letters is not disputed. And the allegation that the claimant has concealed information from the court is, of course, rejected, but that, again, does not raise a factual issue as between the parties. And I would just note, Your Honour, that those letters have been issued after the claimant sent its first notice of termination. And in any event, those documents are now before the court. Paragraph 54 contains a bare assertion that there is a substantial dispute of material facts and that any further investigation would further broaden the scope of inquiry of the court. But, Your Honour, that is not elaborated upon. Simply asserting that there is a substantial dispute as to the facts does not make it so. The defendant has not identified a single substantial fact that is in issue between the parties. Your Honour, the defendant also challenges the claimant's claim and the remedy sought, which is a simple declaration as to termination of the contracts, and suggests that it's an improper remedy unless consequential relief is also sought in relation to that declaration. And Your Honour, the answer to that lies simply in Article 37 of the DIFC Law of Damages and Remedies, which, if Your Honour wants to read it, is at Bundle 4, Tab 5. And simply says, Article 37, declarations, the court may make binding declarations on points of law or fact, whether or not any other remedy is claimed. And Your Honour, in relation to declarations, further guidance can again be taken from the Forest Heath case at paragraph 27, which is at tab 4 of the same bundle, Your Honour. Paragraph 27, and Justice Ramsey is quoting from the decision of Justice Neuberger in Financial Services Authority in Rock, where he says, the power to make declarations appears to be unfettered. As between the parties, it seems to me that the court can grant a declaration as to their rights or as to the existence of facts or as to a principle of law. And then further down in the second paragraph of that quotation, it seems to me that when considering whether to grant a declaration or not, the court should take into account justice to the claimant, justice to the defendant, whether the declaration would serve a useful purpose, and whether there are any special reasons why or why not the court should grant the declaration. Your Honour, the useful purpose to be served in this case is the cancellation of 72 contracts that have been on foot since May 2015, despite the fact that the defendant has not paid the purchase price to the claimant, and which it seems can only be cancelled by virtue of court order. In considering justice to the parties, the court is requested to have in mind that it cannot be serving justice, that the claimant has to maintain the contracts whilst deriving no benefit from them. That makes no commercial and certainly no legal sense. Your Honour, I'd like to draw your attention to some concerns that the claimant has as to the way in which the defendant is seeking to reframe and misstate the claimant's case, and in particular allegations of improper conduct. I trust I don't need to convince Your Honour that the allegations that the claimant has misled the court by withholding information is not valid, or that the claimant is attempting to circumvent the court's processes as ordained by statute, which is asserted in paragraph 11 of the defendant's skeleton argument. If Your Honour looks, for example, at paragraph 6 of the defendant's skeleton, it is said that the defendant has not, the claimant, I beg your pardon, has not expressly brought information to the court's attention. However, the defendant goes on to say that the relevant documents have been placed before the court, and indeed those documents were included in the claimant's witness statements. The defendant's assertions that the claimant is only seeking declaratory relief and not consequential relief to avoid a higher filing fee, and by some circuitous route seek to claim the amount of the security deposit, is of course wrong. The claimant's claim form and particulars of claim make it very clear that the only claim that the claimant is pursuing is for declaratory relief, which is entirely appropriate to be made pursuant to the Part 8 procedure and for which the appropriate filing fee has been paid. Your Honour, at paragraph 9 of the skeleton, the defendant says that the claimant seeks a final injunction. I have no idea where that has come from, Your Honour. That's simply not correct. As the claim form and the particulars make clear, the only remedy sought by the claimant is for a declaration as to the termination of the contract. And in terms of the security deposit check, Your Honour, which are dealt with at paragraph 15 and 16 of the defendant's skeleton argument, there is a difference between seeking enforcement of the check and the bounce check and the criminal proceedings that were undertaken by the public prosecutor for the bounce check. The claimant has not sought to enforce the security deposit check either in the civil courts of the Dubai courts or in this court. And whether the security deposit check was wrongfully presented by the claimant is not a matter for consideration by this court. It is a matter that was under consideration and should have been raised in the criminal proceedings brought by the Dubai Public Prosecutor. Your Honour, at paragraphs 18 and 19 of the skeleton argument, the defendant suggests that the contracts were frustrated by external acts beyond the control of the defendant. Your Honour, that is not accepted. The contracts remained capable of performance, even if the SBLCs were not able to be in cash due to compliance reasons. It was always open to the defendant to make payment of the purchase price by some other means, for example, a manager's check, which was even contemplated in the contracts. But he has not done so. At paragraph 41 of the defendant's skeleton argument, it is said that the claimant has not rejected the SBLCs. Obviously, Your Honour, it is not for the claimant to reject or to accept the SBLCs. That is a matter for the relevant financial institution. It should be noted that Mashreq Bank has in fact rejected the SBLCs, and this is set out in the defendant's first witness statement at bundle 1, tab 12, page 89 at paragraph 30. Bundle 1, tab 12, which is on page 89, Your Honour, at paragraph 30. And in fact, he says the SBLCs were rejected by the claimant's bankers, plural. If we look at paragraph 59 of the skeleton, Your Honour, I would just note that it is the defendant's inability to satisfy compliance requirements that resulted in Mashreq rejecting the SBLCs, not some inability on Mashreq's part. As to the assertion that the defendant would not be prejudiced by a declaration that the contracts are terminated, that is not accepted. There is nothing preventing the defendant from bringing a claim if he wishes, if he's so advised. And I should note that the claimant never encashed the security deposit check, as is stated at paragraph 59A. It was merely presented, but was dishonoured, and so was never encashed. Again, Your Honour, any allegations to the wrongful presentation of the check should have been made before the criminal courts during the conduct of the criminal proceedings. It is that court that is the competent court with jurisdiction to deal with matters relating to the check. Your Honour, paragraph 59C of the skeleton argument is merely a hypothetical. Paragraph 59D suggests that the Part 8 procedure does not allow the defendant to bring a counterclaim. However, I note there's been no identification of any possible claim that the defendant might have against the claimant. As to paragraph 59E, the defendant has had ample opportunity to submit his evidence in response to the Part 8 claim, and he doesn't identify what further evidence might be adduced if Part 7 proceedings were to go ahead. Your Honour, to summarise, there is no substantial dispute of fact between the parties. Accordingly, the Part 8 procedure is entirely appropriate for the consideration of whether a declaration of termination of the contract should be made. The simple fact is, Your Honour, that the claimant has not received payment of the purchase price, and the contract should now be declared cancelled, whether pursuant to contractual provisions for termination in accordance with Clause 6, or whether pursuant to statutory provisions, whether that is under the UAE Civil Code, and of course, Your Honour, noting that there will be further submissions in relation to the application of the Civil Code.
Thank you.
Yeah. Your Honour, with your permission, I am representing the defendant in the instant proceedings. With your permission, Your Honour, I would first like to clarify the facts, the circumstances, and the issues relevant to this matter that has been brought under Part 8 of the DIFC court rules. This is important because ultimately the question boils down to whether there is a little dispute of fact which can be determined in a short hearing, or if there is a substantial dispute of fact that would merit a proper investigation of facts and issues. While that is the most obvious question that I would address in this submission, Your Honour, but first I would like to point out three broad things that are on my mind, which I feel are relevant for the court's determination, in order to have a background idea of the facts and circumstances of this case. Your Honour, defendant does not question the right of the claimant to file a claim seeking a declaration that I have validly exercised my right to terminate the contract in respect of the 72 units. We do not doubt that. That's not an issue. I am rather concerned, defendant is rather concerned about the claimant's reasons for seeking such a declaration. As the claimant in its last witness statement stated that the reason why it wants such a declaration is because it wants to sell the 72 apartments to certain identified or certain purchasers. And that's why this declaration is absolutely necessary in the facts and circumstances of this case. Concern is, if this was the reason, then why did the claimant not proceed in seeking such a declaration prior to presenting the security check to the bank? Why did the claimant not approach the defendant and say, let's terminate this by mutual agreement, because we have not been able to perform the rights and obligations of the parties. In fact, in the last witness statement, the claimant says that, in fact, this contract, in fact, no obligations were performed under these contracts. If the intention of the claimant is that only a declaration should be granted by this court, then I want to ask only one question. I invite the attention of this Honorable Court to the particulars of the claim. This is hearing bundle number 1, tab 2, page 7. Your Honor has got the page 7?
Yeah.
Your Honor, if you read the first paragraph and the only paragraph on this page, it says, the claimant reserves its rights to claim compensation and or damages from the defendant, including for the amount of the security deposit check and for any other losses arising as a result of the defendant breaches of contracts. Your Honor, a question has arisen. That why have I pleaded prejudice? A question has arisen. If you want to see the simple declaration from this Honorable Court under an alternative procedure of the court, because the question is, the claim would have been filed under Part 7, the claim may be filed under Part 8 if the requirements of Part 8 are met. Part 8 is an alternative procedure. It has certain limiting principles, Your Honor. It limits my right to present a detailed statement of defense, to bring detailed evidence before this court. It limits my right to file a counterclaim. There are certain limitations under Part 8 procedure that are not there under Part 7. So if the same relief would have been claimed under Part 7, but same relief was not claimed under Part 7, but was claimed under Part 8, and there is a submission in the particulars of the claim, wherein it is stated that I reserve to myself the right, Your Honor will have to then consider, rather necessarily consider, in the event this Honorable Court grants such a declaration, under Part 8, whatever may be the facts of this case, the logical effect would be that they would use this declaration, which this Honorable Court has granted, and file another claim seeking with absolute certainty the amount of security deposit of the check. This would also be a validation of the fact that they have rightfully presented the security check. It is the defendant's submission, Your Honor, that the circumstances in which this check has been presented are very critical for this Honorable Court to determine. The claimant drew the attention of this court to a very important provision of the contract, which is Article 6. In fact, I will take you through Article 6, Your Honor. Article 6 changes the entire, if a true interpretation of Article 6 will determine where we stand in relation to this case. Because after all, it is stated in Article 6, under what circumstances they have the right to retain the deposit. Now the question is the mere non-performance of a contract an issue? But then why did Article 6 use the term violation? Which means, why did it use the term act or omission? Which means, I am the person who must do something as a result of my act, or I should not do something as a result of which I will be held liable. I draw your attention, Your Honor, to Article 6, of which is in Volume 3. Page 347.
Yes, we
have already seen it, Your Honor. Your Honor, the Article 6 reads as follows. In the event the buyer fails to pay the payments as agreed on the agreed date in Clause 3. So the first test is, in the event buyer fails to make the payment, then it says or. So it refers to the second event. Fails to complete the transfer on the agreed date, so second event, So both these events, event one and event two.
Yes. The agreed date, which is 7th of June 2015.
Which was later extended by the claimant to 18th of June, as Your Honor has already mentioned in the beginning of the proceedings. So agreed date may have changed. And I'll definitely take Your Honor through the circumstances to show what is the consequence and the effect of that change of date as well. But Your Honor, at this point in time, Your Honor, I want to bring to the end, because this is the crux of the case, Your Honor. If I succeed in bringing to your attention whether Article 7 has been breached or not, the issue for determination in this case, whether they validly exercised or they did not exercise, it may throw some light on that issue. Now, here there are two events. First event is, I should have failed to make a payment. Second, if I failed to make a transfer. But these two events, Your Honor, are qualified by act or omission. What claimant is saying is, with regard to failure to make payments, it's not on account of act or omission. It could be because of any reason. What I'm saying is that these two events must necessarily, the word act or omission must necessarily be read with both the events. Why? Because the subsequent part of this section says, due to his own act or omissions, then the seller has the right. So a right accrues to the seller to terminate the contract only when these two events are qualified by an act of omission. So I must have done something, or I must have omitted to do something, as a result of which the right, a cause of action, accrues to the claimant. And then this sentence goes on, and he shall be entitled to retain the deposit. Now this is very critical, Your Honor. We need not refer to any other contract. In fact, where the parties have agreed to perform a contract in a certain manner, and where the terms of the contract stipulate the remedy, and where the terms of the contract stipulate the circumstances in which a particular check may be held or in cash or not in cash. So we need not look beyond that. If we look within the realm of Article 6, Your Honor, Article 6 itself says that he shall be entitled to retain the deposit, and then it is again qualified by a fourth test. It says, as long as the termination of the contract was due to the violation of the agreed terms. Your Honor, fourth line says, the termination of the contract was due to the violation of the agreed terms. So there are four things that come into action. One, I have failed to make the payment. But this, my failure to make the payment should be as a result of my own act or omission. If it is a result of my own act or omission, there is a breach. A cause of action accrues to the other party. The other party can then exercise its right to terminate because there is a violation. So unless these four ingredients of Article 6 are not satisfied, there cannot be a violation. Your Honor, I may give a very hypothetical example just for the purposes of, suppose I buy an apartment from DIFC, and I sign the sale and purchase agreement, and I have not made the payment, and I die. Now, the reason I was not able to make the payment in the instant case was because I died. Now you cannot go after my estate and say, you have to sign, so your estate is liable to pay for this. Because there was no act of omission on my part. Something happened beyond my control. Applying Article 6 to the facts of the instant case, Your Honor, here we have a very classic situation. We have a situation where the defendant, and I can demonstrate to this Honorable Court, with absolute particularity, with specific reference to the letters, and the evidence that has been put on record, that we did what we could do under the given circumstances. And now the method of payment under Article 3, as we have seen, is that we will make this payment through a standby letter of credit. Defendant's account is in a bank, EIB, in Spain. The correspondent bank is the merchant bank in the UAE. An SBLC is open, instructions are issued to the merchant bank. They have to credit this amount which to the account of this. So my job is to open an SBLC. My job is to ensure that this happens. If for any reason it did not happen, I should take alternate measures to make sure it happens. The question is, did I take alternate measures in this case? Did I do what I was supposed to do after it happened? The answer, as I will demonstrate with the facts of this case, is yes. I went and I said, let's go to your other bank. Let's do it directly with your Emirates and Middle Bank. Now, how would you send money from an account in Spain to an Emirates and Middle Bank here unless there is a sort of a relationship between the two parties? I will establish before this Honorable Court what steps we took to establish that relationship and what is on record. Because this record was presented to the other party. The other party has not disputed what we have presented before the Honorable Court in our witness statements. I'm going to present those facts before you. This is the broad overview of the case in which this case has to be ruled. But first, before I proceed, the first question before I go into the facts of this case is whether this case is maintainable under Part 8 proceeding or not. And I think the most important case which was cited by the Council, is the Forest case. What I like about the Forest case is that it has very clearly laid out the jurisprudence for this Honorable Court. I will read out the same test which my learned counsel read about this Forest case. Because I believe that this case is so critical, the test with regard to when a party application should be followed and should not be followed is so clearly stated in this particular thing. But before I take you to the relevant paragraphs of this judgment, Your Honor, the question is, if you are seeking a declaration under Part 8, now what are you seeking a declaration about? Existence of a fact? Principle of law? Those principles of law must be clearly established before this Honorable Court. Not only clearly established, to the satisfaction of this Honorable Court. Now, let's say that those facts and the claimant has succeeded in convincing this Honorable Court today that this is a fit case where this Honorable Court may pass a declaration under Article 8. My concern that arises from this case is, this case says, even this is not enough. The Honorable Court must move one step forward and it introduces the appropriateness test. I will show you those paragraphs, Your Honor. The appropriate test is, even if such facts, principles and rights are established to the satisfaction of the court must not grant, such an order unless it is appropriate to do so. Now, what is the word appropriate? How has the court defined the word appropriate? What is appropriate and what is inappropriate? There are four principles in this case, Your Honor, when you analyze this case. There are four principles that are culled out from this case. Your Honor, the first principle, as the claimant rightly, counsel for the claimant rightly pointed out, is it should serve justice to the claimant. The second point which the learned counsel rightly pointed out is it should serve justice to the defendant. The third principle is it must serve a useful purpose. There must be a useful purpose in granting the declaration, Your Honor. And the fourth and the most critical element of this case is there should be special reasons. The reasons must be so special. Now let's say there is justice to the, you have looked into justice to the claimant, justice to the defendant, and you feel that a useful purpose is served. But are there any special reasons as a result of which you should grant this order? Now, this case has been beautifully analyzed because, after all, Your Honor, in this case, if you exercise your power, Your Honor, you are going to exercise your discretion. After all, your discretion will be guided by certain facts and issues which have been established before you. So that if your exercise of your discretion is guided by those facts, then it must serve a useful purpose. It must, and then the fourth element point is, it must help. The court says it must help to achieve the aim of justice must be achieved. So all these beautiful points laid together must achieve the quintessential, the paramount consideration, which is aims of justice will be achieved. Is there a little dispute of fact? In my humble opinion, sir, there is a substantial dispute of fact. Can a short hearing dispose it? I'm afraid, sir, a short hearing may not be able to dispose it. The proper determination of issues, Your Honor, will require a disclosure of documents. Assuming, Your Honor, if you grant this order today, the prejudice would be caused to me. I'll just tell you in practical terms what is my prejudice, Your Honor, and what is my greatest fear. My greatest fear is personal liberty. Your Honor, defendant, the check was presented. before the criminal court. I'm not a lawyer licensed to practice before Dubai courts, but I hear from my lawyers who are appearing before Dubai courts that when a check is presented, all that the criminal court looks at is, was this check issued by the other party, and was it does not look into the totality of circumstances, whether it should, whether it was rightly presented, whether it was wrongly presented, what were the circumstances under which it was presented. That is for the civil courts to adjudicate. In this case, his lawyer did not appear.
Did you read the criminal judgment?
I'm afraid, sir, I have not had the opportunity to read the criminal judgment. I confess that I should have, but I was not able to do so.
Bundle 1, unfortunately, is not in the English language.
So I could have translated it into English.
But the judge has dealt with the point which you referred.
I will definitely seek, with the permission of the court, I'll definitely translate it and read into this point. Your Honor, my concern, and here I stand, here I am not speaking in my capacity as a lawyer, here I'm just trying to learn from the court. My concern, Your Honor, is, and I may be completely wrong, that if I have been convicted and I'm serving a sentence, now I was thinking, it's my view, that if this declaration is given against me, what will happen is, I will not be able to file a case before the DIFC courts and present all the circumstances before the DIFC courts and say that, look, this check was, these are the circumstances under which this check was presented and these circumstances were not right. There is a possibility that upon reading my evidence, upon reviewing my position, the DIFC courts may say that the check was wrongly presented. If I succeed in obtaining such a declaration, I would take the declaration from this honorable court, Your Honor, and I would go to the prosecution or to the court. I know that a sentence has been given and sentence cannot be, if well given, and now this cannot be set aside. But I can ask for a suspension of the sentence. I'm not sure if this is a procedure. But I can ask for a suspension of the sentence and I can say, look, the court has given me an order in which it felt this check was not wrongly presented. I will file a claim against them and say, this check should be returned back to me because you have wrongly presented the check. The question is, if they are saying that the contract was never performed, what about then? Why are they seeking this declaration, sir? Your Honor, why are they seeking this declaration? There must be existence of a legal right which they want to terminate. If they say you never paid us, therefore we never transferred. My property was never registered before Dubai Land Department in the interim register. If this is the consequence, if this is exactly what has happened, Your Honor, then what is the purpose of seeking this declaration? What I want to bring to the attention of the court, Your Honor, before I take you on to the specific instances that I have complied with my obligations, Your Honor, under the contract, is I will suffer great prejudice. It is not a case that is fit under Part A because learned counsel said that it is not a substantial dispute of fact. Let's analyze the proposition of the learned counsel. She's saying the only issue in her skeleton, the only issue for determination in the instant case is that I failed to make the payments. This is not in dispute. The payments were not received. This is not in dispute. So since both the parties agree that payments were not made and the payments are not in dispute, therefore, the court must grant the declaration. One point she's not referring to, Your Honor, is the breach. And the moment you refer to the breach, Article 6 comes into picture. And the moment you refer to Article 6, those four elements of Article 6, event of default, was it a result of my act or omission? Was there a violation? Only then you are entitled to retain the deposit. Because the circumstances under which they can retain, I could very well understand if Article 6 was not there. If Article 6 was not there, you could refer to all the provisions of law. You may see I have not even commented in my skeleton on the issue of Article 272, Article 267 of federal law for a specific, because it was not relevant at this stage. Because my Article 6 was so strong, Your Honor, that there was nothing left for me to argue. So that's what I'm saying. If you view it from this perspective, there is a substantial dispute. You may say this is a question of law. Agree it's a question of law. But a question of law is based on certain set of facts and issues. Now, those facts and issues are in dispute. Now, to seek a declaration whether this court should grant a declaration that I have lawfully exercised my right to terminate the contract. What does that entail? That entails I rightfully presented the security check. I have rightfully encashed the security check. That means I have followed all the provisions of Article 6 and telling the court, do not look at Article 6. Now, that is not fair and that is not appropriate. If I succeed in demonstrating before the court at this point in time that this claim is not maintainable, I have proved my case. But if I have to go into the specifics of this case to demonstrate my that I have followed, I have done all that I could do, I invite the attention of this Honorable Court to heading bundle 3, page 347. Unfortunately, there is one difficulty which we all face, Your Honor, in this case is...
Bundle 3, page?
Your Honor, I stand corrected. Yes, heading bundle 2, tab 17.
Okay, page?
Heading bundle 2, tab 17, page 215. Yes.
Start from 208.
1 second, sir, Your Honor. Heading bundle 2, tab 17, page 215.
215.
215.
215. Yes.
Your Honor, this is the SDLC that I have opened. You can see at page 215. If you turn to the next page, which is page 216, it says, and the fourth paragraph, the standby letter of credit is assignable and transferable. The reason I am bringing this to your attention, Your Honor, is because a question was raised. Why did you open your SDLC in the name of your own company, Moon Trading, and not in the name of this particular company? Your Honor, at that time, my payment was subject to the NOCs being obtained. At that time, at that particular point in time when this SDLC was opened, those NOCs had not come. So what I did was to show my intention to the other party that I want to perform this contract. I immediately opened an SDLC and showed them that I opened an SDLC in the name of my company and this SDLC is capable of being transferred. Your Honor, at the time those contracts came into existence, those NOCs came into existence, I immediately wrote to, I draw the attention of the Honorable Court to heading bundle 2, tab 17, page 222. Your Honor, this is the letter that I have addressed. Unfortunately, Your Honor, I have to apologize, I have not included this, but the print is so small that if you permit me, I will read it, and the claimants counsel can correct me if what I have read is right or wrong. This is a letter to the branch manager of Mashriq Bank. I say I highly appreciate your excellent services and your cooperation. With this, I would like you to transfer the SDLC issued by Emirates Investment Brazil in the name of, issued in the name of Emirates so and so. And then in the second paragraph, it says, I request you to transfer this instrument to the following DIFC bank account. And the DIFC bank account is given below. It's not disputed. So I have, through our communication, written to them that please do so. Now, the best part is that DIFC does not raise an objection to this, Your Honor. They accept this. For acceptance, I draw the attention of this Honorable Court. Same tab, page 223, Your Honor, the next page, the very next page. In the very next page, Your Honor, will see that Dubai International Financial Center has written and they have said, in conclusion to the above so and so, hereby accepts to receive one-year irrevocable guarantee issued by so-and-so to be advised by Mashriq Bank on so-and-so. So I can't read this whole thing, Your Honor, but if a clear copy is given to the Honorable Court, this Honorable Court will appreciate that this SDLC, which I opened, was accepted, Your Honor, by the DIFC.
But again, this is the first SBLC.
Yes, Your Honor.
But rejected from Mashriq Bank.
Correct, Your Honor.
This was doesn't mean that the money is transferred.
Correct, Your Honor. This is, there are two other facts which have to come to this notice of this Honorable Court. And this is exactly what I'm leading to, Your Honor. Because you are very correct, Your Honor. This SBLC subsequently, what I want to, the reason I'm quoting these instances, Your Honor, is I want to bring to the attention of the court that I am doing everything that I could do, rather more than what I could do, to ensure compliance with it. It's not because, Your Honor, after reading this whole case, after reading the evidence on both the parties, of my client and this, it appears to me that they didn't want this transaction to go through. For example, a reliance has been placed on the statement of Mr. Amin before the Honorable Criminal Court. I have not been able to see the statement of, I mean, what was it that made the Mashriq Bank to exactly stop? We were told there are some compliance issues. We don't know exactly, Your Honor, what those compliance issues are. We are told there was some Interpol case opened against you. But we don't know whether this was really an issue that was presented before the Honorable Court. Somehow I feel that if this proceeding would have been under Part 7, this court would have some evidence from the court.
But already the criminal judge at Dubai Court referred to the Interpol case. That's why I'm saying you have to read Dubai Court judgment.
Yes, Your Honor, this is my ignorance, and I apologize to this court, and I completely know that perhaps it is not as if I could not have obtained it, but it was an error on my in my judgment.
Your Honor,
going through the document.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but possibly I can say so. I've managed to obtain translations of the judgment.
That's okay. Yes.
I will. Your Honor, the reason I'm drawing the attention to these various SDLCs and the rejection of these SDLCs and coming to the point of, I will only point out to the tabs. I won't take much of your time, Your Honor. I will go through it very quickly just for you to note the points. Alternatively, if Your Honor feels, I can make a small submission in writing referring to those submissions, whatever Your Honor feels. But Your Honor, the short point is that I have done on 29th June 2015, if you look into the hearing bundle 2, tab 17, same thing that you have in your hand, and if you turn to page 298, Your Honor, I am writing to the gentleman who is the property real estate agent of the other party. I'm telling him, in the event our efforts to cancel so-and-so deal with the remaining issue is transferable standby letter of credit, which is in the Mashriq Bank since 2015, 3rd June 2015, and which we have been requesting the bank to transfer into DIFC investment account. And since we didn't get any action from Mashriq Bank till today, we come to the suggestion, which is why we don't send this instrument directly to your account to avoid this delay. So in that case, Your Honor, it's not written in very good English. But what the person intends to convey is, would it be possible if we send it to your account directly? So can we work out a procedure where this is done? Again, I want to bring to the attention of the court that I'm taking every single effort, making every single effort to do it. And Your Honor, it is interesting that you have already seen Mr. Rajesh Parikh and Mr. Saleh Al-Arabi's witness statement, wherein they have stated that this was rejected because of compliance reasons. Your Honor, there is a letter dated 6 September 2015, which I will not open, but I just pointed out to you, which is in Hearing Bundle 2, page 328. Same thing, page 328. This letter says that SDLC was referred back to Mashriq Bank instead of informing DFC because of compliance reasons. Now, as you have seen, we have asked the property developer, we are finding ways and means of moving forward. But an important email that I want to bring to your attention is the email dated 7th July 2015. This is Hearing Bundle 2, tab 17, page 299. This is very important, and this is very clear, because this is a part of our submission. Your Honor, this letter says, we send this email to DIFC, informing them that we would like to thank you for supporting on finalizing the 72 units in Motor City. Next paragraph. We would like to ask you to help us MX and BD to accept RMA request being sent by so-and-so bank attached. If we can have RMA established between MX and BD and this bank, then we can. It will help us resend the transaction and future transaction to your good self. Kindly note that we are ready, willing, and able to send MT-799 followed by MT-760 to your account in MBD once RM is established. Your Honor, this is very important. The reason why this is important is because if you look at MT-799, again, this is a banking term, Your Honor, but what it is that it is a form of a swift message in which a bank confirms that the funds are in place, the funds are there in place. So it's a sort of a confirmation from the bank that the fines are there. And then MP7, which is followed by MP760. MP760, the issuing bank issues MP760. So it says that these funds which are there have now been put on hold for the purposes of this transaction. Your Honor, through this letter, after all, Your Honor, if you see the context in which the letters were drafted, it was not the intention of the defendant that one day this case will fall apart. Defendant wanted these apartments. This is precisely the reason, because when you open an SBLC, there are certain charges. Defendant was paying the charges in respect of those SBLCs that were rejected. It's a different issue that I'll bring to your attention, that two other SBLCs were subsequently opened after termination. That is a very important event that I will shortly come to. And the best part, as I've been given to understand by my client, is that he is still paying charges in respect of those SBLCs. And I asked him why. And he said, simply because those SBLCs have not so far been rejected. Now, this is something which I have not got a chance to evaluate and look into in absolute detail, but this is an important fact that I will shortly bring to the attention of this honorable court. Your Honor, there is another important letter which is updated in the same day and the next page. We have looked at page 299, this is page 300. I am writing to the property agent of the other party, and I have informed them that, look, please find attached our letter that I have sent to them. This is page 300. Page 300, yes. We sent hard copy. Now we are saying this. We have sent a hard copy of the RMA request to Mr. Rahul, who is the real estate agent. Now, there another important letter that we have written, which is very important for this honorable court, is letter dated 12th July, which is, if you turn to page 310 of the same thing, 310. Your Honor, this is a letter which I wrote. And in this letter, Your Honor, I am writing to Mr. Saleh Al-Rabi, who has submitted a witness statement. I am saying we thank you for your time on Thursday for meeting at your office. So we met him, Your Honor. We met him on 12th of July, 2015. In continuation of the meeting and due to delay of Mashed Bank, due to all the process of the deal, we would like to inform you that we are willing and able to conclude the deal on the following terms and conditions. We shall send the SBLC directly to Emirates NBD. The RNI message has been sent and Emirates NBD is working on it to complete the formalities. This can be checked by your good selves with Emirates NBD. And with your support, we are sure we can conclude it with Emirates NBD. Upon acceptance of new things, we shall establish MP-799 immediately followed by MP-760 upon your acceptance of MP-799. The total process can be done within 4 working days, including MP-760 upon your acceptance of MP-799. We request you to meet with you again and negotiate the SBLC discounting charges which you shall incur. This was our misunderstanding of the issues and terms of the MOU. We shall need an additional 15 days extension as we shall need to renew the issued NOCs. Because, Your Honor, these NOCs that are issued, after all, they are not issued indefinitely. So they're issued for a specific period, Your Honor. So here all we are saying is, please grant us time so that we could at the same time get the NOCs, you know, these things issued. I understand your reasons for the delay and give us another chance. Your Honor, please read this. Please look at the conviction with which we have been writing and we have been finding ways. The important point is we didn't stop. It cannot be argued, Your Honor, that my SBLC failed and I didn't do anything. What I'm trying to prove to the Honorable Court, through the timeline of events, through the chronology of events, on a daily basis, I'm taking necessary steps. On 22nd July 2015, Your Honor, the same hearing bundle, I invite your attention to page 312. This is a very important letter. Again, I'm writing to Mr. Saleh Al-Aribi. I'm telling him the important points I'll summarize. In second paragraph, I say, now it is the responsibility of DIFC to submit the required documents to Emirates NBD to establish and receive the SBLC. Your Honor, between two banks, I cannot interfere. I can only tell them that there is something which you need to give to Emirates NBD. You need to ask them what it is, and then establish a relationship with the bank so that the bank can communicate directly with the other bank and SBC can be established. And in the second last paragraph, I say, in order of this letter and the letter sent earlier dated 8 July and in continuation of our telephonic conversation, I would like to meet you to conclude the deal. Your Honor, I am requesting for a personal meeting. If a person's intention is wrong, the person will only send an email and leave it at that. I am requesting for a meeting. At this meeting, at this moment, and all the delay so far has been by the banks. And since the information to receive the SBLC was not provided to the receiver bank, also our bank, EIB, already have a relationship with Noor Bank and many other banks in the UAE. But the SLB can be sent only upon your acceptance and information to your bank. Somebody has to accept it, Your Honor. Somebody has to provide the information, Your Honor. Kindly ask your concerned department to finish the formalities with the bank, including submitting of all documents related to the deal to the compliance department of your bank. Your Honor, I did that. I mentioned it. Of course, the counsel is right. I did not know which documents are required. I did not know what they should do. I presume that they have a relationship with the bank, and their bank is not going to talk to me. Their bank will only talk to the person who has an account with that bank and tell them what is required to be done in order for them to process the transaction. Such a thing did not unfortunately happen in the instant proceedings. Your Honor, from 22nd July until 3rd of August, there was nothing that happened. On 3rd of August, Your Honor, this is the most critical letter at page 314. Just one page away. If you turn to page 314. 3rd of August is a very critical date for me.
It is 2nd of August.
This letter is dated 2nd of August, Your Honor.
Yes.
But I presume that this, because it is sent by a letter, if you see one letter behind it, in front of it, it is letter dated 3rd August. So initial MANZ25 is dated 3rd of August. But the letter that was attached with this is dated 2nd of August. Now, this is a reminder letter, Your Honor. In this reminder letter, Your Honor, this is very important. I am writing to them and saying, Mr. Rajesh Kumar Soni, Managing Director of Blue Chip Real Estate, he's the real estate person. I'm saying, in continuation of our discussion and due to the delay of Mashal Bank to transfer the SBLC during all the process of the deal, we also already tried to send the SBLC directly to your Emirates NBD account, and it was rejected due to non-existence of relationship between Emirates NBD and EAIB. Either provide us with one of your account or help us in establishing relationship between Emirates NBD and EIB. Here I'm asking them, okay, if you don't want to give me information about Emirates NBD, provide me information of any other bank account that you have. I presume you have more than one bank account. Also, just to bring to your notice, in order to finish this deal, we have already paid service charges, NOC fees, deposits in MEPool, etc., to complete the transaction. So we have also already done that, not in dispute. We are long-standing and very serious to complete. Now, Your Honor, I'm begging them. I'm saying I'm very serious to complete this transaction. Please assist me. And then I say, for all the above, we request from you as trustees to hold the above-mentioned check. Now, this is the most critical part, Your Honor. Please, Your Honor, my date is important. 2nd of August. Letter dated 2nd of August, which I sent on 3rd of August. For all the above reasons, we request from you as a trustee to hold the above mentioned check till we reach an understanding to proceed with a complete transaction with DIFC. Your Honor, I know they are going to present my, because they have written to me, I know they are going to present my security check. I am telling them, please hold on to this, because if you can do this, a relationship will be established between Emirates and my bank and Emirates and BD bank, money will come directly into the account. If you cannot do this, give me another bank account. I'm saying I want to meet you. I want to discuss this. Please do not encash this security check, because I know the consequences that will flow from encashment of this particular security check. Now, Your Honor, this, in my opinion, if you see the time period, this 3rd of August, my check on 3rd of August, because I have that my check is bounced. But our bank, Your Honor, our bankers rather, they go and they tell the DIFC to come back with this check again after 3 days and inform us that this is what they are intending to do. This document is HB2, which is tab 329. Those are the same thing, page 329. On, Your Honor, at 329, it's very clearly stated. This is the check, Your Honor, which was presented. And if you see the reason, it is said 3 days here. You can read the check here because it's not very clear, Your Honor. So, Is it clear, Prof?
Not clear.
Your Honor,
the customer return advice.
I present
advice. Yeah, not clear, the reason.
Your Honor, if you permit me, may I? I have a clear copy here.
Yeah,
if
yes.
I can. Circumstances, Your Honor, under which this check was being presented. Your Honor, on 3rd of August, we write a letter which is very, very critical to Mr. Saleh. This is page 316. Now, your letter, Your Honor, if you read this letter, this explains, actually this letter kind of sums up my, what is it exactly I was trying to do. This letter kind of sums up part of it. In continuation of my letter dated so-and-so, I will read only the relevant part, Your Honor, and also in continuation of our meetings, we have been trying to complete the deal from day one. As also as mentioned before, due to the delay of Mashriq Bank to transfer the SBLC during all the process of the deal, we also already tried to send the SBLC directly to your Emirates NBD account, and it was rejected due to non-existence of relationship between Emirates NBD and EIB. During all our negotiations, we did not expect, now this is, Your Honor, this is like a declaration, during all these negotiations, we did not expect you to deposit our security deposit check, as we are still under negotiations. This is the point, Your Honor. As we are still unable to complete the deal, we are still willing and able to complete the deal as per your requirement. We are already agreed and undertake to pay the discounting charges. And also, as mentioned in a letter, we are willing to reply to this letter, so and so. Then, through this letter, we again ask you and our stand and ability to close the deal and complete the transaction. Once again, I am requesting them to complete the transaction. DIFC shall not do their part of documentation with your concerned bank. Once the SBLC is received in DIFC bank account, DIFC shall start the process of discounting. We hereby. So, this letter, Your Honor, if you read it, it just sums up a sense of what I have already read earlier. So, I don't want to repeat the essence.
And your client now in the jail or?
Your Honor, my customer is not in the jail right now, but he is.
And he is willing to proceed or to enforce the contract.
Your Honor, what I gathered from him, he wants me, I'll be very honest with him before this honorable court, he wants me to prove to the court that what he has done is not wrong. And I told him it's not possible because I'm in a party. I cannot do beyond a certain point. I cannot produce evidence. I cannot bring more than the time that honorable court is giving me today to present. That's all I have to bring to your attention, the facts of this case. Your Honor, he wants to show this honorable court that he did what he could do, Your Honor, in the given circumstances. It is a question of fact. It cannot be denied. Even if an expert, a financial expert, is appointed, he will look into and he will tell the honorable court that once he did what he had to do, it is not his act or an omission that led to his default. Now, what is happening, Your Honor, is DIFC also is not clearly responding, as you can see from the facts of this case. He's approaching them, he's meeting them. They're not simply taking a stand in this particular instance. When we analyze all the facts together, Your Honor, it appears as if the DIFC did not want at one stage to proceed with this gentleman for reasons best known to them. But what I, as a lawyer, and I'm simply, as an officer of this court, I'm simply bringing to the honorable court the evidence I saw, although I'm representing the defendant, but I'm bringing to the attention of this honorable court the evidence I saw that made me believe that I can come before this court and tell the honorable court that this honorable court must look into the evidence in great detail. Now, Your Honor, I can go on and on this case, but doesn't it prove one important point, Your Honor, that there is not little, the dispute is not little, the dispute is big. If the dispute is not little, the dispute is not small, it's substantial. And if this is a substantial dispute of fact, then as the Honorable Judge Justice Ramsey in the Forest, he wrote this. The points that I brought to your attention, Your Honor, he said in this case at paragraph 37, I do not consider, he was analyzing, Your Honor, a case about a steel thing where certain quote, iron quote was, one complaint had to be put, whether it should be put before or later, and an adjudicator had said there was a delay of 36 days. And in those facts and circumstances, the judge was writing a decision. The judge said, I do not consider that there is a limited factual dispute which can be resolved under Part 8 or by means of a hybrid Part 8 procedure involving a short hearing. Because a hybrid Part 8 procedure would only apply, Your Honor, if I have a small issue of fact or an issue which this Honorable Court can immediately dispose of in hearing. My concern is, there are so many facts, Your Honor, I can simply go on and demonstrate to you one by one that what I have done. So if you reliance on this judgment will show that I have complied with my obligations, Your Honor. I understand, Your Honor, that this contract was not for, I did my best. I mean, rather I should say, Your Honor, I have a claim against them. My claim is, you've got a judgment against me as a result of which I have a conviction. Now, I have engaged a lawyer because I want this lawyer to help me. So, unfortunately, when I met the claimant, I saw the difficulty. The difficulty was some people were taking him into Dubai courts. He went, Your Honor, notice in the case file. A case was filed in the DIFC, Dubai courts. And Dubai courts, his argument was, of my client was, that I want you to perform the contract and I want you to transfer these units in money. Now, clearly, and at that time, Your Honor, two facts I want to bring to attention now. I can also plead them specifically if you want. First fact is, when my check was bounced, when this happened, what I did was I immediately opened another SBLC, a fresh SBLC, for an amount of 10 million or 10 point security deposit amount. Your Honor, then I opened another SBLC, second SBLC, a new SBLC for around 170. I opened it immediately, Your Honor. The purpose was that I wanted to tell them, please don't proceed with this, do it in cash. Unfortunately, those SBLCs have not been rejected so far. At least on record, I have not seen any document given to me by my client, which shows, and based on my client interview with my client, that those SBLCs have been rejected. My question.
That means if DIFC proceed with the payment, they will get the payment?
This is the logical, this is exactly the logical. The money is there, Your Honor. The money is there.
And the case will be settled?
The case will be settled, Your Honor.
What do you think, Shaun?
Well, Your Honor, my understanding is the money isn't there, and that's the whole point. And I think that's something that has been addressed by the Dubai courts in the civil proceedings as well, Your Honor, it was actually addressed in the criminal proceedings, that on the evidence of the representative from Mashraq Bank, there wasn't sufficient evidence to show that the defendant had that money in his account.
Your client is willing to proceed if the money exists. This is my question.
I mean, I can take instructions on that, Your Honor, but I mean, certainly the payment would have to be by some other means than an SBLC, because we're right back where we started from, which is compliance issues that will not allow the banks to release the funds.
On the alternative method of payment, this manager's check.
Yes.
Correct.
And I believe, Your Honor, that was actually something that was offered to the defendant in the course of the negotiations during this period that we're talking about presently, and that was rejected. So, as I said, I'm happy to take instructions, but there will certainly have to be an alternative method of payment.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Go ahead.
Your Honor, if I draw your attention to Volume 1, Hearing 1, page 82. I'm only referring to this, Your Honor, to drive home the point that this is Mr. Rajesh Parikh's witness statement. And at paragraph 33, Mr. Rajesh Parikh, at page 82, says, on 10th November 2015, Mr. Zia commenced fully unfounded proceedings in the Dubai courts against DIFCI on an order for transfer of the title of properties to Mr. Zia's name. That claim was dismissed by the judge at the Dubai courts of the first instance for want of jurisdiction. and that decision was not appealed. Now, Your Honor, clearly if one court does not have jurisdiction, it will dismiss the case. So it was not. The point is that my case was not dismissed on merits. So therefore, my client's intention, had it been a Part 7 proceeding, clearly you would have seen a counterclaim before you, or if no case was filed against. And there is one more interesting fact that I completely forgot to bring to the attention of the court. Your Honor, if we look into the evidence of when the case was decided by the, if you see the criminal court decision, once they file the case against me and I am sent to prison, what happened, sir, is on 21st October 2015, the prosecutor accepted the complaint. And thereafter, in the year 2016, early 2016, a judgment has come against me, sentencing me. And it is unfortunate that the lawyer who was engaged did not appear before the court on the date of the hearing. Now, Your Honor, why have they filed the Part 8 procedure? There is one very important thing that has happened. Now, if I'm in a situation where I've been sentenced and the law of the land only permits me one escape, which is I bring to the attention of the competent court of jurisdiction the facts and circumstances which will demonstrate to the Honorable Court that I am innocent and my check was should have not have been presented. Instead of us coming before the court and for us to approach the court, what happened is, I presume, I'm not saying with absolute certainty, a thought came to the mind that could it be a possibility that this Part 8 proceeding was filed thinking that he would not appear and thinking that if a declaration is obtained from the court, res judicata will apply, he cannot then on the same cause of action challenge the declaration of the Honorable Court because the court has already passed a judgment. If that happens, assuming that happens, as I've argued in the skeleton argument, great prejudice would be caused to me. Here it is a question of my personal liberty. Here it is not a question of amount in consideration. Here is a question of an opportunity to demonstrate before this court that these checks, where this particular check was wrongly presented before the Honorable Court. So this is an important consideration, Your Honor, that has to be kept in mind. Again, second important point was, you're asking for declaratory relief. You reserve your right to ask for the consequential relief. But you ask for declaratory relief and you only pay $5,000 as your court fee. Had you asked for a consequential relief proceeding, would have been under Part 7. And you would have to ask for, you would have to pay 44 or 46,000 approximately, as we calculated, something around that figure as the court fees. That was not paid, Your Honor. So that's why I used in my last part of my skeleton argument, Your Honor, I said, it should not be the procedure, the process of the court must not be abused in such a manner to do indirectly what the law does not permit you to do directly. What is ordained by the statute should not be circumvented by any process of law in any manner whatsoever. Your Honor, I can, if this Honorable Court instructs me, I can go through other parts, but if this court has wants me to sum up my main points, I can bring them to your attention.
So far, so clear for me, but if you want to add more.
Your Honor, I would just like to add one or two points more, and then I would not go into everything, I'll just go into one or two points more, Your Honor. Page 318.
In which bundle?
Hearing bundle. This is hearing bundle 2.
Page 3?
Your Honor, page 318.
Okay. Which is the unclear?
Unclear letter, Your Honor. I have also made some attempt to read it and to understand it. But this letter is very important, and I thought some important aspects I may attempt to read before the Honorable Court. This is a letter which has been written to me. Your Honor, please note all the sequence of events that I brought before this Honorable Court. Amid this sequence of events, this letter is issued to me by DIFC Courts on 11th August 2015. Now, Your Honor also asked one question to all of us, to both the counsels. What was the date on which you were supposed to complete the contract? What is the date on which you were supposed to complete all your obligations? And we said to you, sir, this date initially was this. It was extended to 18th of June 2015. Now, Your Honor, 18th of June 2015, 11th of August 2015. There is a time period in between. And there are a sequence of events that have happened during this relevant time period, Your Honor. Now, in this particular letter, if I may, with your permission, Your Honor, read the second, third paragraph. A 10% security deposit was paid by you on the date of signing the property sales agreement. In the event that you default on your obligations thereunder, DIFC could have insisted on the security deposit being paid in cash. However, DIFC accepted a security deposit check instead. The agreed method of payment was irrevocable SBLC in the name of DFCICI for the purchase price to be issued on the date when DFCI would receive no objection certificates from the developer so-and-so. On 3rd June, you issued an SBLC for the purpose of the property. So we admit for the purposes of the property, however, SBLC issued was in the name of your company, Emirates Moon, and this was not in line with your obligations. After all, they accepted it also. Which clearly stipulates that DIFCI should have returned a beneficiary under SBLC. On 14th June 2015, DIFC received NOCs from the property and you were immediately informed about it. After receipt of NOCs to encash the SBLCI, but as DIFC had no standing on SBLC, your bank refused to release the funds to DIFCI. Thereafter, without prejudice to DIFC's right under the property sales contract, in good faith, to accommodate your requirements by providing you with a letter dated 14 June, which you submitted to your bank, but which, as we understand, was not sufficient to release the funds in favor of so-and-so, DIFCI was also being asked to establish a link between DIFCI, Emirates NBD account, and so-and-so, or to provide substitute bank account. They admit that. These were new requirements. So they said this was not agreed in the contract. These are new requirements which you are introducing, which were not entirely clear to DIFCI, and it is certainly not what the DIFC originally contracted for. So the point, Your Honor, is that they admit and they agree. All the points I showed you, they admit and they agree, Your Honor, that yes, you did this, but I never agreed with you to do this. You are bringing in a new condition. This was not part of the original contract. And by it is essentially not what DIFC originally contracted for under the property sales contract. By 18th June 2015, you were unable to abide by your obligations under the property sales contract. And at that point in time, it was perfectly legitimate for DFCI, and then they say, Your Honor, it was perfectly legitimate for DFCI to encash the 10% deposit as per clause 6 of the security contract. So what is established, Your Honor, is that they exercise their right to terminate this contract or encash the security check under Article 6. That's why I read the interpretation of Article 6. That is why Article 6 becomes important. That is why a determination by this court of the true interpretation of Article 6 becomes critical. And they say, and thereafter, we had given an approval for the same to be encashed. RERA had given an approval for the same to be encashed. But the security deposit was not honored due to unavailability of funds in your account. DIFC hereby wishes to terminate the property sales contract due to your failure to pay the purchase price with the deadline. So, Your Honor, a decision is communicated to the other party that now through this letter, we are finally terminating the contract. But we have also encashed, we are doing this on the 11th of August. Before terminating the contract, Your Honor, we encashed the security check. We presented the security check. Now we are saying that we believe, the DIFCI believes, that you are in breach of the contract and hence we have exercised our right to terminate the contract. My question, Your Honor, is DIFCI not a party to the contract? Is my client not a party to the contract? How can one party make a unilateral determination and a final determination that the contract has been validly terminated in accordance with the provisions of the law, especially in accordance with provisions of Article 6. Article 6 is the most critical element of this contract, Your Honor, that defines the relationship of the parties, because it says under what circumstances the other party can retain. The word used is retain the deposit in Article 6. And Article 6 uses the word, Your Honor, violation. Let's go back, Your Honor, to the reading of Article 6. I draw your reference to Volume 3, Hearing Bundle.
Yes, it's before me.
Yes, Your Honor. Your Honor, Article 3 says, in the event the buyer fails to pay the payments as agreed, or fails to complete the transfer on the agreed date, Your Honor, the words are, due to his own act or omission. The only difference between what the claimant is arguing, Your Honor, and between what the respondent is arguing is the word due to his act or omission. If you see the skeleton of the argument of the claimant, they say that in the event the buyer fails to make the payment as agreed, this you cannot read, the claimant says you cannot read due to his act or omission there. But with regard to the second part, or fails to complete the transfer, that is which should be on account of act or omission. The reason, Your Honor, I do not agree with such an interpretation of the claimant is because this contract, this particular paragraph, is followed by two other things, which says, then the seller has the right to terminate the contract and he shall be entitled. So there is a right to terminate the contract and he has the entitled to retain the deposit. Now again, there is a non-substantive clause, as long as, it's like notwithstanding anything contained therein, as long as the termination of the contract was due to a violation of the agreed terms. Your Honor, the contract, Article 6 requires a violation. A violation requires an act or an omission. Act or an omission means, suppose this Honorable Court finds today that you opened SBLCs, we don't doubt that. You made every single attempt to do that, we don't doubt that. But the question is, then the only relevant question for consideration before this court is there anything before this Honorable Court that I was supposed to do, that I did not do, that I omitted to do? If there was something that I omitted to do, Your Honor, an arguable case can be made out under Article 6. They have a right to terminate the contract and they have a right to forfeit the deposit. In the instant case, I have shown you the 3rd August scenario where the check has bounced. An 11th August letter where we are told we are now terminating the contract.
Sorry to...
Your Honor.
Now in Article 6.
Yes, Your Honor.
My understanding from your submission that the seller is supposed to return back the check to the buyer, not in cash the check. This is what you want to say.
This is, Your Honor, has got the essence of, yes, Your Honor. The essence of what I want to say, you have summed up beautifully in 2 lines. But, Your Honor, I'm also saying that the only reason this is happening is because the contract says, Article 6 says that mere non-performance, Your Honor, a distinction
needs to... I'm afraid that because I'm comparing now.
Yes, Your Honor.
The language.
Yes, sir.
So the contract is written in both languages, in Arabic and in English.
Right, sir.
And the Arabic side is very clear.
Yes, Your Honor.
If the seller fails to comply with the Article 3, then the check will be due to the seller, which the seller will not retain the check. Again, if we go back to the Article 19 from the same contract, would you mind reading, please?
Article 19, Your Honor?
The same contract.
Yes, Your Honor. In case the discrepancy occurs between the Arabic and English texts with regard to the interpretation of this contract or the scope of the application, the Arabic text shall prevail.
Okay. Now, this court is the official language is in English.
Yes, sir.
And it's fortunate, and I don't know, I can't read Arabic. So there's a, my understanding, there's a misunderstanding of interpretation of the Article 6 from both parties, because the translation is not correct, not proper. So now, as an English, as a court applying the English language, and the parties agreed to apply the Arabic text on the any conflict between Arabic and English text, which text I'm going to apply and explain the Article 6, do you think?
Your Honor, if I go strictly by the contract, this thing goes against me. And because, as per the contract, if there's a dispute, the Arabic text shall prevail.
We'll see.
This part goes against me if viewed in this perspective. But Your Honor, I want to distinguish this if you permit me. Because now the case has changed. It has taken a new dimension, as Your Honor has pointed this point to attention. Your Honor, I want to now simply raise one, rather make an attempt to see if I can persuade the Honorable Court to address this case from a different perspective. Your Honor, I was reading, essentially, English is the first language of the DIFC. The institution that is that issued this contract is the DIFC. Now, if the language that should be used to understand by default should be the interpretation that is contained in the English language, and if you allow me to confine myself further because I am unable to comment on the Arabic and I am grateful for that, it may well be, Your Honor, that the English, it may well have been the situation that an English draft may have been given to the other party. And Your Honor, the translation looked into. So, Your Honor, an important point comes to mind. Because English is the first language of the DIFC, of course, Your Honor, so the presumption would be that the contract was first essentially drafted in English and thereafter translated into Arabic. Now, if we look, had this contract, Your Honor, a difference, now had this contract been drafted in outside of DIFC, the position would have been that you would then have an Arabic draft with an English translation thereafter to follow. In the instant case, we have an English draft followed by a subsequent translation. So the case is distinguishable.
But the parties agreed that Arabic texts proceed.
Your Honor,
what do you agree that the Arabic texts supersede the English? Or the Arabic preview?
Yes, Your Honor, that is Your Honor, that is a point which is contained in the contract, and Your Honor has very rightly pointed that out. But my response, which may be taken on record on this issue, is I'm making a distinction, Your Honor, on this issue, saying that if English is the first language of DIFC, the presumption is the contract was drafted in English. So the language in which the contract is drafted should be the language that should be taken into account for the purposes of the interpretation. This is my submission.
But the contract is drafted in both languages.
It's a bilingual contract, Your Honor.
Yeah.
So you're absolutely correct. But because English is the primary language of DIFC, because this contract was first drafted in English and not in Arabic, what is there in Arabic is a translation. Now, Your Honor, let's go behind the rule that if the contracts are normally, in many places we have seen, that whatever is in Arabic will be taken into account. We make a power of attorney. It's a bilingual power of attorney. We go before the notary public. The notary public only looks into the Arabic part. Because the document was essentially prepared in Arabic and translated into English. In the instant case, Your Honor, I would like to persuade the court to look at this point from this perspective. From the perspective that I received a contract which was first translated into English, which was first in English, drafted in English, then translated into Arabic as per the rules of procedure of this institution. So a translation of the original. So a translation will always, so if the translation is correct or the original is correct, we will always say the original is correct. The translation cannot prevail. If we look in this thing, we will have to look into the legal maxims of the dictionary and see whether the original contract drafted in English should be taken as the final contract or whether an Arabic part, Arabic translation of the same should be taken into account. Now, in Dubai, mainland Dubai, outside of DIFC, all the documents are in Arabic. So, if there is a conflict, the logical conclusion would be that the Arabic part the Arabic part of the contract will prevail because English is only a translation of the Arabic. So, Your Honor, if I were to argue before you that in this instant case, notwithstanding what the parties have argued, we cannot, the second submission, Your Honor, is parties cannot contract out of the mandatory provisions of the UN law. Now, for example, the DIFC law requires the proceedings to be in English. Now, even if the parties have agreed otherwise, Your Honor, even if the parties have agreed otherwise, that it will be in Arabic, translation will prevail. Parties cannot contract out of the statute. Can the parties enter into an agreement and say that there is a 51% local sponsor, 49% others, and they say he's the 100% owner of the property? We don't have a trust law inside in Dubai. So we cannot draft a contract which will go against the statute. So the parties cannot contract out of the mandatory provisions of the law. I submit before this honorable court.
Which is, take me again to the which law the court going to apply on this dispute. Mm-hmm. The federal law as the claimant submitted, or we're going to apply the contract, DIFC contract law?
Your Honor, this case is before the DIFC courts. The jurisdiction of the courts are guided by the DIFC court rules. The courts are guided by the substantive provisions of the DIFC, the substantive legislation in DIFC law, of DIFC law. Clearly, the courts will have to apply this law. Clearly, if the courts were to, let's put it, Your Honor, I'm not sure if I'm saying that.
So, I'm not pressing to answer now, but I'll give you an opportunity both to do a submission in regard Article 3 of Federal Law Number 8, 2004, which is the civil and commercial, the federal civil and commercial law is exempt from applying within the DIFC.
So Article 3 of?
Law Number 2004. Yes. Article 3 of Law Number 4.
Of?
Sorry. Number 8, 2004 is a federal law in respect of the financial free zone.
And yes, Your Honor, it's an exemption of the application of the federal provisions of the federal civil code to the DIFC.
Yes, this is what I'm referring to.
Yes, Your Honor. Your Honor, even if, because I was trying to base this case, a part of this case rather, even I am now going to argue before this honorable court that even if Article 6 were an issue which would pose a concern, this case can be disposed of without reference to Article 6. Now that, I will take 5 or 6 minutes of your time, Your Honor, of this honorable court to bring that point in issue. But before I go to that point, I would like to conclude my submission on this issue, which pertains to which language the court should follow. I confirm to the court that I will do an analysis on this subject as the Honorable Court has posed this query, and we will submit it to the Honorable Court for its kind consideration. Your Honor, but on one important thing comes to my mind. I was arguing some matters, Your Honor, in relation to a case where there was an award from the Act. And the DIAC award came into this court for enforcement and ratification. Opposite party came and they filed an application challenging my award here, and then they went into the DIFC courts. I came before this court and I filed a petition, and I said that this amounts to an abuse of the process of the court. The Honorable Judge, Sir Justice David Steele, in his judgment, he said, rather in the hearing, he explained to me, he said, that look, the award, the nationality of the award is of Dubai. The default seat of jurisdiction is of Dubai. If we have to judge whether the award is to be nullified or not, or should not be nullified, has to be done by the courts of Dubai because they are the tribunal courts. If the courts of Dubai would apply the law, they would not apply the DIFC law. They would apply the law of the court of Dubai. The federal law, I mean, my federal law. So my application was not taken into account, but costs were not awarded because it was a mistake I had made in my application of the law. But that guidance, which I got from this Honorable Court, Your Honor, and if I apply that guidance to the instant case, and if I went to make an attempt before this Honorable Court to bring these important considerations before you, Your Honor, I would argue as follows. I would say that this case is before the Honorable DIFC Court. If DIFC Court has to judge the validity of this contract, it will have to be judged in accordance with the laws of the DIFC, notwithstanding the fact that what the parties have stated, because this court must first apply its own law, the law of this jurisdiction. Now, if that were to happen, Your Honor, assuming that this interpretation is correct, then, Your Honor, my argument before you just a short while ago was that if the principal language of this Honorable Court is English, and if the contracts, Your Honor, have been drafted first in English, and only a translation was made in Arabic, so I have a vague recollection of reading Black's Law Dictionary, where the issue was, where some in one point somewhere, I don't know where it was explained, I'll bring it to the attention of the court, that where there is a dispute between the document that was prepared in the principal language of the jurisdiction and a translation, it is the English version that will prevail and not the Arabic version. So even though it is stated in the contract, even though parties have stated in the contract and they have said that yes, we will Arabic part will prevail, but this Honorable Court has to then exercise its discretion because it has to exercise its laws and to see its own laws are not violated. So, Your Honor, as you have very kindly given me the time to address this issue, I will address this issue in detail there, but for the purposes of record, I wanted to sum up the critical points in this regard. Now, Your Honor, if Article 6 were not there, let's say Article 6 is not there, and I have failed to convince the court on the interpretation of Article 6. In the absence of this very critical Article 6, Your Honor, I am left with only one argument before this Honorable Court, which is Part 8, which is there's a substantial dispute of fact, which is this court must be guided by the test which was given in by the Honorable Justice Ramsey in the Forest case. The test being that if you are seeking a declaration under Part 8 as to the existence of a fact, then those facts must be established to the satisfaction of the court. I have established before you, Your Honor, with evidence on record, that there is a dispute. I have shown that it's not a little dispute, it's not a small dispute, it is a big dispute, it is a substantial dispute. And even if this Honorable Court were to feel today that you are convinced that this dispute is not substantial, I would say, Your Honor, please follow the appropriateness test. And this appropriate test has four elements: justice to the claimant, justice to the defendant, whether it serves any useful purpose, and if there are any special reasons for doing so. This is what Justice Ramsey has said. And the effect of this test of appropriateness is, Your Honor, that I will suffer prejudice. They have reserved to themselves the right, as Your Honor has seen, to bring a claim against me for recovery of that money and damages. I will not be able to appear before this Honorable Court and file a claim against them and say, I have rightfully presented the security check. So even if, Your Honor, Article 6 were to be a fetter that would come in the way of, in my way, to seek justice, this case has been wrongly filed under Part 8. This case should have been filed under Part 7. Proper fees should have been paid and they should have asked for relief. Your Honor, I would like to sum up unless this Honorable Court has questions for me, I want to sum up my case in the following manner. If the only issue for determination before this Honorable Court is whether Part A applies or Part A does not apply. The relief that we have sought in our application and now in before this Honorable Court, is that this is not a fit case at all, even remotely. Because the determination, because the claimant has argued that the only issue that this court must determine today is that money was not paid. Your Honor referred to Article 6. Your Honor said, in my opinion, the Arabic version says that this is all that the claimant needs to do. I'm asking them the equitable question. What if I die? And what if, Your Honor, I have signed a contract and I die? Then you cannot force my estate or my legal heirs to be bound by the terms of the contract which never came into effect, which never came into existence. So there has to be an intentional act or omission on my part, because otherwise the principles of justice, equity, good conscience would be violated. Sharia, the law, the Article 5 of the Constitution of Uae says that Sharia law should apply. And one of the most constitutional principles of Sharia is equity and balancing the principles of both the parties. In my case, if you do not balance my principles simply because you interpret that interpretation of Article 6, it will completely cause me immense prejudice, because ultimately my goal is to get my client things suspended against him. So all the roads that lead to that suspension, I want them to be open, Your Honor. I want to be in that position to make an application before this court and say that my check was wrongly presented. I cannot do so, Your Honor, in these proceedings. You have been kind enough to hear me at length, but I cannot make this application before you. It has to be a Part 7 proceeding. I request this Honorable Court to exercise its discretion, keeping in view principles of justice, equity, good conscience. Take into account the prejudice, the word is prejudice, to my client that would be caused if this declaration comes under Part 8. So I request this Honorable Court to dismiss this application.
Thank you. Yes, Sharon, you want to add something?
Thank you, Your Honour. Just a few small points, Your Honour. Firstly, in relation to the language of the contract, I think we need to be a little bit careful to assume that it was originally drafted in English. It's not actually a DIFC contract, Your Honour. It's actually a Lands Department contract, and it's the standard form Lands Department contract, okay, which is available.
Then I will ask both parties to submit an official translation to the contract, especially Article 6, with the authorized translator within Dubai. There's an authorized translator offices in Dubai can translate the contract.
Your Honor, that's fine. We can certainly do that. My understanding, though, is that the contract actually appears in English and Arabic as a form that is provided to the parties to then fill in the details. Mm-hmm. But I will make inquiries and can confirm that to the court. But certainly from the claimant's perspective, it wasn't a draft that it first did in English and then it was translated to Arabic. This is something that's been provided to it externally. Your Honour, just touching on some of the other points that have been made, in terms of the prejudice that the defendant says that he would suffer in the event that the party proceedings are allowed to continue and a declaration for the termination of the contracts is made, that prejudice is hypothetical in the sense of what other actions the claimant might decide to bring down the track. It's not a matter for the court now to take a view on something that may or may not eventuate in the future. It is a matter for the court at that period in time to take a view as to whether or not that is an appropriate course of action. It's said against us, Your Honour, that we are trying to circumvent essentially the large filing fee of a Part 7 proceeding. But Your Honour, if we were to file a Part 7 proceeding seeking a declaration, I'm not even sure what the filing fee would be, because there is no monetary claim. And I think declarations are specifically suited to Part 8 procedures by their very nature, because there is no monetary claim involved. As well as the issue of there being insubstantial facts in dispute. I have to confess, Your Honour, I'm still confused as to what facts are actually said to be in dispute. And of course, in accordance with Part 8, it is facts that must be in dispute for the proceedings under Part 8 to not be appropriate. The documents that Your Honour has been taken to today are not in dispute. The documents are taken at face value. The only question and the only claim that the claimant has is, of course, its claim for declaratory relief. And the facts that support the claimant's position for declaratory relief are not in dispute, Your Honour. And, Your Honour, it doesn't even matter that the defendant has done everything in its power to ensure that the SBLCs could be encashed. The reality is quite simply that DIFC Investments have entered into 72 contracts to sell 72 units. They have not received money for those units, and the contracts remain on foot, and the claimant would like to have some legal certainty as to whether those contracts are now considered cancelled, and they may enter into fresh contracts with potential new buyers. And again, Your Honour, I just want to raise the point that the rejection or the acceptance of the SBLCs is not a matter for the claimant. It's a matter between the defendant and his bank. So to the extent that it is alleged that those circumstances give rise to a dispute of fact, the claimant can only say that it has not been able to receive the funds pursuant to those SBLCs. It is not in the claimant's power to reject or accept those. It is a matter for the financial institutions to undertake that action. And where, if, as the defendant says, his funds are tied up with the banks pursuant to these SBLCs, then his claim is actually against the banks that are holding those funds. And the claimant has absolutely no control over those amounts. Your Honour, and I would just raise the point as well that on the defendant's contractual interpretation of Article 6, the practical effect of that does sound as though the defendant is suggesting that pursuant to the contract, it excludes the right to terminate pursuant to statute, and that the contract is only capable of being terminated if there is an act or omission that has caused the failure to perform the contract. And that simply can't be the case on a commercial or a legal basis, that one party can not receive what it is entitled to expect pursuant to the contract, and yet the contract remains on foot. And so, Your Honour, I reiterate my submissions that this is a practical and appropriate case to be dealt with under the Part 8 procedure. Whether the contract can be terminated pursuant to the contractual provisions in Clause 6, whether it is a matter for UAE civil law, or even whether it ultimately we decide that it is a matter of DIFC law, at the end of the day, the claimant needs certainty as to the current legal status of those contracts. And in justice to both of the parties, the contract should be declared terminated. Your Honour, if I can assist you with anything further.
Thank you. Just to remind you, your submission in regard to the DIFC contract law.
Would you like me to make that now, Your Honour, or would you like me to address that in writing?
In writing.
Okay. I mean, I can make a few points for you, but
yeah,
it may be more coherent in writing.
That's okay.
Thank you.
Anything to add, Mr. Sage?
Just one last point, Your Honour. The Learned Counsel said that it does not matter even if the defendant has taken all steps to get the payment. Ultimately, the fact remains that this money was not paid. So I only wanted to bring this observation, which this court has already noted, once again to the attention of the court, because it confirms my submission before this honorable court, which is that I have done everything that I could do within my power. So if I have done everything that I could have done within my power, notwithstanding Article 6, the court must look into the prejudice element and dismiss this Part 8 application. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for both. And I'm going to reserve this case for judgment. And I don't think so more than 4 weeks as a maximum. And before the 4 weeks, I'm going to hand down my judgment. Okay, and for the your submission, it's possible for next Sunday. Sunday is off. Thursday this week. It's possible. or next Monday?
Thursday is fine, ma'am.
And your reply on her will be next Monday?
Next Monday will be more appropriate.
Okay, fine.
So next Monday will be the date? 24th.
Yeah.
Sorry, Your Honor, just to be clear, so I will file my submissions on Thursday.
And his?
And the defendant will file responsive submissions on Monday.
Yeah. Unless if you need to extend 2 or 3 days.
Your Honor, I'll be grateful for an extension for 2-3 days.
Okay, give me a date. Can I say on Wednesday?
Your Honor, 26th is very good.
26th.
Wednesday.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
All rise.
Thank you.